Let us pray. Holy God, we come seeking you in the midst of our joy and our brokenness, as individuals and as a community. Speak to us the word we need to hear. Be in our thoughts, prayers, words, images, and music, that we might draw closer to you and awaken to the truth of our oneness with all humanity. This we ask, praying the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
On one occasion, when Jesus was going to the house of a leader of the Pharisees to eat a meal on the Sabbath, they were watching him closely. When Jesus noticed how the guests chose the places of honor, he told them a parable.
When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, "Give this person your place," and then in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place so that when your host comes, he may say to you, "Friend, move up higher." Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted.
Jesus said also to the host who had invited him to the banquet, "When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your sisters or your rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return, and you'd be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you. For you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous." One of the dinner guests, on hearing this, said to him, "Blessed is anyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God."
Then Jesus said to this man who had said, "Blessed is anyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God," "Someone gave a great dinner and invited many. At the time for the dinner, he sent his slave to say to those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is ready now.'
But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said to him, 'I've bought a piece of land. I must go out and see it. Please accept my regrets.' Another said, 'I bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm going to go try them out. Please accept my regrets.' Another said, 'I've just been married, so I cannot come.' So the slave returned and reported this to his master.
The owner of the house became angry and said to his slaves, 'Go out at once into the streets and lanes of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame.'"
Mm-hmm. So the slave went out and did as the owner of the house had commanded. And the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, all were invited to the banquet. And the slave said, "Sir, what you ordered has been done, but there's still room."
Then the master said to the slave, "Go out into the roads and lanes and compel people to come in so that my house may be filled."
Scripture we just heard, it's very clear whom Jesus is saying we are to invite to the table. For Jesus, the metaphor of the table is a very important one, and throughout Luke's gospel, there's a lot of different references to eating together. The meal for Jesus represents God's reign, that time of inclusive fellowship that foreshadows God's unending love and God's purpose for all creation, that we indeed one day will know that we are all one. We belong to God and each other. Jesus is using the metaphor of the table to teach his hearers who is included in God's reign. Now, if we understand the biblical context of this teaching, it helps a lot. The people, Jesus says, are to be invited to the table are the exact ones who were not allowed to be priests, and they were barred from worship in the temple. The poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. Not allowed. So here's Jesus turning things upside down. Thank you, Paul, again. The social construct of who's in and who's out gets dismantled in this parable. The people who are first invited are way too busy with the important business of their lives to give any attention to their soul's journey, their need for God. They don't think they need God, so they make lame excuses for not coming to the feast. And the host of the feast says, well, then forget it. I'm going to disinvite you and invite people who will come, people who think they would never be invited. One of the reasons Jesus always tells us to include the poor and the people who are marginalized by their societies is so we can grow closer to God. Not by thinking, oh, we're superior, getting all puffed up because we're doing good deeds for them, for those poor people. Oh, not at all. It's because we have so much to learn from the other, from people who are different from us. Since Jesus knows that for every human being, the path to our wholeness will come in understanding our oneness with all creation, even in the midst of our difference. As we welcome those who are different from us, we learn humility, which is why, of course, this parable in Luke was introduced by another story about humility. The exalted will be humbled, the humbled will be exalted. As we welcome those who are different from us, we learn what it means to be humble, and we receive gifts from those whom we include. And then we learn about new gifts that we have to offer. And the heart of God gets visibly embodied in our midst. Jesus is not calling us to a stance of superiority because we're such good Christians inviting the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. No. And the church better listen. The church is always in danger of getting puffed up about our righteousness. That is not what Jesus is teaching. That we're so good, we've got to go out and bring people in. No. Jesus is calling us to a much deeper understanding of God's extravagant mercy and love of all people. And he's teaching us that for our wholeness, we have to be willing to accept God's invitation to live a life in God, with God, for God. We need to come to the banquet. In this parable, Jesus is also inviting us to begin to see with the eye of the soul, with the eye of God, to see God's abundant provision, and to begin to see God in each and every human being. To begin to see God in the other, in what is different from us. And we learn to rejoice in what is not us. This is what has the potential to free us from our ethnocentrism and free us from our narcissism. The parable of the great banquet invites us to understand our oneness and to receive the mercy and the love that God extends to all. This is what will grow our soul, create our wholeness, and set us free. This parable of the great banquet's rather straightforward. When we understand it from what I would call the outward point of view, we are to be committed to welcoming the stranger, the outcast, the marginalized, those whom the society, even the church, would discard or think are less than. Outwardly, this is the call of Christ to a life marked by commitment to others, not seeking our own self-aggrandizement. However, I would suggest that this way of life is possible only if we also take the inward journey of deep self-reflection and understanding. Jesus calls us to both. A journey outward and a journey inward. The inward journey is the soul's journey of transformation. It is, in short, a path to consciousness. That's why when we talk about growing spiritually, we use phrases like waking up, becoming aware, being reborn. And we use words like enlightenment, or awakening. So, what could the inner meaning of this parable be? I think it has to do with accepting all the disparate parts of ourselves. Just as on the outward journey, We cast out the other in society. Likewise, we try to cast out those parts of ourselves that are unacceptable to us. Usually we do that by hiding or defending or denying that we even have unacceptable thoughts or desires. So, when we look at this parable, we need to be willing to ask, what is the poor, the lame, the crippled, and the blind, to use scriptural language, inside me? Perhaps the poor could represent something inside us that's needy or struggling. Perhaps the lame could represent something inside myself that I think's inadequate. Or maybe the crippled part of myself is that part that has me paralyzed because of a hardened heart or my own quick judging of others. What about the blind within me? Clearly, we each have blind spots. We use that phrase a lot, don't we? Places where we can't see something, another's point of view, perhaps, or take in any new information. Perhaps our greatest blind spot is thinking we don't have one. As the Talmud teaches, we do not see things the way they are. We see things the way we are. Until we recognize that there are many parts of ourselves we hide away, we stuff, we keep hidden in the unconscious. This is what Carl Jung called our shadow. Until we recognize we have one, we're always in danger of projecting these unconscious parts of ourselves onto other people. Perhaps that's really what our fear of the other is. A projection of a part of ourselves we haven't recognized or brought to light. Clearly, God wants to have a relationship with us. That's what the invitation's about. And God wants to understand this invitation is for all, because truly we are all one. That's what the great banquet's about. But there's a paradox about coming to the banquet, and it's this. It is those who have recognized they've been injured or hurt in some way in life who are most apt to turn and come to the banquet. There's no virtue in our weakness or injury, of course, especially if it leads to self-pity or always thinking yourself as a victim. That would completely defeat the creative purposes of God's transformation and wholeness for us. But here's the paradox. Only a person who has recognized his or her own need for God, even in their despair, is ready for the banquet. Well, what about those ones that refuse the invitation? The self-sufficient ones. The ones who make excuses about coming to the feast. Well, we're those people too. Caught in our own egocentricity, our own self-focus, too wrapped up in what it is we have to do, our focus, our shoulds, our obligations. This prevents us from accepting God's invitation to wholeness. When we let the cares of this world, as we see them, overshadow our need for God, our soul's growth is stunted. So awareness is the first step to opening ourselves to wholeness. Well then, let's follow Jesus' admonition and build a house of welcome. On the outward journey, of course, welcoming all people to the banquet of God's love. But on the inward journey too, welcoming all the disparate parts of ourselves to the banquet as well. For the banquet represents God's abundance and God's provision and the fullness of life to which God calls us. The banquet represents God's mercy and God's love poured out for our healing and our wholeness, and thus for the healing and wholeness of the whole world. This being human is a guest house. Every morning, a new arrival, a joy, a depression, a meanness. Some momentary awareness comes as an unexpected visitor. Welcome and entertain them all. Even if they're a crowd of sorrows who violently sweep your house empty of its furniture. Still, treat each guest honorably. He may be clearing you out for some new delight. The dark thought, the shame, the malice. Meet them at the door laughing. Invite them in. Be grateful for whoever comes, because each has been sent as a guide from beyond. This poem by the Sufi mystic Rumi, to me, could be the words of Jesus as well. And I think of Carl Jung saying, in our dreams, if we dream of a house, it's ourself. There's many rooms in there. And sometimes in our dreams, we'll be wandering through the house, looking in all the rooms. I like Rumi's idea. It's a guest house. Welcome everything in, because God is at work, redeeming everything, making everything that was disparate whole. That is the soul's journey. This morning, as we receive our offering, I would ask the ushers not to bring it forward, but to take it where it needs to be deposited, because we're not going to stand and sing a refrain and do our prayer of dedication. Paul is taking this time to finish his beautiful painting. We will receive our offering, and then you will know what to do with it, ushers. This parable is about grace, isn't it? Freely poured out and out and out and out beyond what we could even see or imagine. And we know that generosity is a fruit of the Spirit. And because of your generosity, I know God is at work in and through you. We have all received grace upon grace. And now let's take a moment to freely give.
Thank you. I invited Pastor Paul to just say a few words. You get to hear him speak as well as think.
Thank you, Pastor Marty. Thank you, all of you, for having me here this morning. What an absolute honor it is to be here and share in the gospel with you. And my hope is that from the scripture that you heard this morning and from the beautiful music that you heard and from the painting, that you will know that with Christ Jesus, there are no exceptions. That this word of promise has come to you again this morning because of the power of the Holy Spirit, so that you too, specifically you, would know that Christ is for you and takes all of those things that have failed in your life, all of those dreams that perhaps you're even living out, but you just can't carry them any longer. Christ has something in exchange for that. He has what he has to give you, his promise of eternal life and forgiveness, so that you can know for sure that you belong to him. And that's what this story of the great banquet is about, that through the cross in the upper left come all of these things that we carry, but then Christ takes that upon himself, and the resurrected Jesus welcomes you to the table, a table of abundance, no matter your age or your place in life. There you are, seated at the table as well. It's the promise of the gospel, and it's a promise that Christ gives to you. And for that, we say thanks be to God. And God's peace be with you.
Thank you.
It's typical that we take a time to reflect, and I invite you now to do so. In the earlier service, we had an intimate moment where we were able to speak out and say what we saw. We're not going to have time to do that right now. But one of the things that came up is not just what you see, but what you don't see. The canvas started out empty, just as our lives do. And then it was filled with something of great beauty. But on some of our canvases, we don't see that beauty. Maybe we see something ugly. But what you don't know is through this power that Pastor Paul and Reverend Marty and the scriptures speak about, there's the ability to wipe that canvas clean and then write something beautiful upon it once again. And so as we reflect before we go into that time of prayer, if there's anything on your canvas that you think you don't want to be there, anything on that canvas that you think takes away from the beauty of who you are, I invite you to let that canvas be wiped clean so that God can write God's beautiful, beautiful work of art upon your soul. Amen. Let us reflect on that for just a moment. God of the banquet, thank you for making each of us your most precious guests. In a world that divides itself into illusory categories, separating one from the other, you, by your divine mystery, see us all equally welcome at your table. Even when we ignore the welcome, your very true heart of hearts always leaves the door open. Help us now to enter in. Feed us with the spiritual food we need to live into your promise for us. Embolden us to take on what it means to be your children in the world, and help us to acknowledge your presence and your power in and among us. As we lift up our prayers, let us trust that you hear more deeply than we can ever know. In our own community, we continue to hold in prayer and in our hearts Ernie Filer, Donna Klopp's husband Tom, Kate Riddle, as well as Maya Yeager and her family, and Bob Mathias, who is having some tests this morning. And in the wider world, we hold in our hearts all of those adversely affected by the weather conditions right now, those who are plagued by war and strife and that's unimaginable to us, the people of Flint, Michigan, and others who live in the peril of being ignored, let them know that they are welcome. And if they are ignored because of racism or ageism or any other ism that we can create, let them know that you can uncreate that ism. God, help us to help ourselves, to love ourselves so that we can share that love with the world. Make us harbingers of hope rather than heralds of hate. And strengthen us who look to Jesus as our model, to see in each other what he sees in us, a people worthy of God's outpouring of grace. And bless the ministry of Pastor Paul Oman today, who takes the invisible and brings into the visible so that we can see your word in a different form. We thank you for all these things. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We'll just take a short moment for invitation to community life. I heard there's some kind of game going on today. I don't know. So I know some of you, you know, that's a second worship experience today. So I would invite Shelley Spaulding, who said she needed to make an important announcement about this evening, to come forward. Thanks, Shelley. While Shelley's coming up, I do want to thank our arts ministry for inviting Paul and for all the work a team did to construct the easel and get the canvas ready, and all of our musicians today, thank you. It came together beyond what anybody could have ever imagined. And we thank you again, Pastor Paul, for being here.
So out of the generosity of this congregation, we have several donated spots for the Marty's retirement dinner this evening. So for those of you who may have procrastinated or your plans may have changed and you are available to come tonight, if you will see Linda Norberg. Linda, where are you? Linda will just hang right about where she's at after the service. If you will see her, we can get you on the list for this evening's event.
Thank you. I did want to take a point of personal privilege because I think my son and his family have only been here once in 16 years, way before Levi was born. And they're up in the balcony. There's Dave and Levi waving, and Francie. And some of you know, but some of you don't. Dave is the David Cowan that wrote Welcome to This House that we sing every time we have a new members, and the choir sang it so beautifully today. Thank you. So we have one more hymn before we are sent on our way to fellowship, to the table, to buy something of Paul's if you'd like. And if you want to order a print of this, you can do that at the table as well. Let us sing, Let Us Build a House, Marty Haugen's famous hymn.
Thank you.
to love and serve God. May this God, whose grace is unceasing, whose mercy is unfailing, whose love is unending, whose light is unfading,
bless you, and you, and you, and you, with hope unwavering. Amen.